This is a niche topic, but I'm going to focus on not just any kind of manipulation, but continual manipulation, and also in time allows. I have until 2:30 for the break. I'll talk about a little bit of heart rating, transfer operations, but also perception of manipulation. So, continual manipulators inspired by the invertebrate structures found in nature, such as an octopus tentacle or an elephant trunk. The figure there, right-hand side, on the top, you see a three-section continuum manipulator called the octopus that was developed by Ian Walker's team at Clemson University. Denoted the three sections, and the three sections are pneumatically powered. The connection is tangential. And the bottom figure here shows a teleoperated operation for whole arm manipulation using the off arm. And Ian and I, we have a joint NSF grant, so our group's task is to add autonomy, to have autonomous algorithms to control this kind of robot and plan motions of this kind of robot. So we consider a more general model, not a three-section, but an N-section manipulator. Each section has some 3 degrees of freedom, control 3 degrees of freedom, and its shape can be described by for each section, the shape is described as section length. Length can contract or extend, and section curvature that can change. And also the orientation angle between two sections. So you can see the different sections with different planes before a spatial curve. And each section, when it is intact, now contact the endpoint, is circular and defined a section plane. So this type of manipulators much more flexible than articulated arm because it has infinite passing degrees of freedom when the robot is, so it presents a softer or compliant front to interact with obstacles, objects and obstacles. Objects. So that's more flexible for whole arm manipulation and in classroom environments such as search and rescue from the city. And in a structure that's very confined, and the regular arm cannot get in, but this type of arm has more chance of getting in to get something out of it. Okay. So we first started the existence of grasping configurations and focusing on just the three section of our manipulator. So given a target object somewhere, the question is, does a solution, feasible solution exist that satisfies the kinematic constraints of the robot? And we assume that we have we define a type of grasping by a circle around the object. You can see that there's an object, you can have almost infinite ways of approaching and trying to wrap around the object. So the question is, how many ways? What we found is, if the tip section is around the circle of an object, then there are multiple connected regions of solutions. And in each connected region, the solutions are very similar. But if more than one section is around the, wrapping around an object, then there are only finite solutions with satisfying the kinematic constraints. But what if we have an N-section manipulator, and it's much more interesting to see if we have an object, we extend the N-section manipulator, and we can form a stable force closure grasp. That means we can both drop an object. So this video shows one approach. If we starting from some initial configuration, and then we starting to curve each section from the section of the first section contacting object all the way to the tip to form a spiral grasp. And then we do a force focus shape to see the final configuration is stable or not. If not, we adjust the scale. So this shows it's an experiment to show exactly the same type of motion. And that's the outcome at the Clemson University. Well, this is not sped up, so that's the actual speed. Okay. However, if we have some obstacles around, then you can see what happens. So that means this kind of open arm wrapping around the object doesn't work very well. Another failure case. Strategy one tends to use, it's more aggressive but uses more maneuver space. So it stops quicker than strategy two. Strategy two uses the least amount of maneuver space. So there's a clear time space trade-off here. Strategy three is in terms of time and space use. So this page shows how we are dealing with collisions. If we can consider different types of collisions and have strategies to change the variables or the arm sections by either flattening it or curving it more and try to repair the collisions and find new configurations. Okay. So here shows the new strategy of grasping in the cartridge space. then to do training and then to operate. So we have an overhead kinect sensor to see the object environment and to detect where the object is. And then the robot just moves to grasp it. This grasping is a planar grasp. Well, it actually is kind of not exactly planar because the planar, because we do lift it to show stable grasp. And this is a 1.5 sped up of the accuracy. And this is a, this part is really the joint work between my group and the EM group, as you can see all the children involved there. And we move the robot very slowly, very cautiously, because there's no closed loop control, it's all open loop. We just give the algorithm and we just drag the robot. This whole thing is anonymous. And it shows if we have a constrained orientation. position of the tip could be orthogonal to the surface of the injection. And you can see the space is quite limited between the structure and the obstacle. Now, this algorithm is very, very general. It applies to any mesh, for any structure, in any environment, really. So this shows, the next one shows a, oops, what's going on? Postpone. Yeah, so this one shows a structure that's not pipe-like, not circular anymore. It's just some polygonal structure. And the orientation constraint now is 45 degrees between the tip axis of the robot and the surface. And the robot base is again fixed. Yes. Okay, finally, I don't think I'm trying for the other subject, but finally, let's just show a little bit of the real action with the tip of position of the tip of robot fixed. Oh, this paint. I know this doesn't look too exciting to be the toy structure, but the algorithm applies anyways to the structure. Okay, I think now it's 2:31, so I don't want to use any of your more of your time. And I'm going to skip all this other stuff for some other opportunities to talk. And just want to acknowledge all my collaborators, including my current student, Jing Lee, who is the major researcher for this new manipulator work, and Ian Walker, Akuma Kaparian, and also John Lindbergh, Robo Crazy. These are people in the nuclear power industry that have really inspired us for applying this type of robot to the inspection, and some other people for the work that I haven't shown. And also acknowledgement to the funding agencies and so on. So that's it. Thank you. Very useful for the medical applications inside the human body. We see a lot of if the test robot.
Yes. So is there something inherent in the theory that doesn't get fixed in the close application, even that you, I think you get the visual feedback, so I was wondering why didn't you consider
it
closed?
I think there's some paper published on the closed loop. But obviously, you have the visual information kind of closed
loop.
It's just that when we do the experiment, the robot doesn't have a closed loop.
Okay, great. Thank you.